Ice Salaam Alaikum. Welcome to another show. My dear brothers and sisters, we're streaming live all over the entire world, and I'm so excited to be able to do that, to just amaze me with this wonderful technology. If you notice, some of you recognize the book, Touched by Elijah. I said, if I could advertise everybody else's book, and Mark, you mean to tell me my sister, even though I didn't write it, but why not? She loves it, and so you should love it, I guess. But anyway, it's a beautiful black and white cover, I know that. Photographs sometimes much more valuable than you'll ever realize. But two of the books that I'm really moved by, The True History of Jesus and The Birth of a Savior. And before I introduce my guest, the reason I say The True History of Jesus, everybody recognizes The True History of Jesus. But many of my Muslim brothers and sisters, they'll say, I know that book. Is that yellow book, like the little yellow bus that my brother attributes some of the people are riding on. Call him up, he'll tell you what it means. And you better do some investigations, make sure you don't fit the mold. But brothers and sisters, The Birth of a Savior is a wonderful book. It is a wonderful book, and it exposes so much in the teachings that you are unaware of. And I say you're unaware of it because if you haven't read it, we certainly tried to limit the tape from being put out there. So every now and then you'll find someone who may have gotten lucky and got a copy of the tape. But for the most part, we've been able to keep that as secure as possible. And you know, it's difficult to do that in this age. You say, well, why would you keep it secure? Because it was important to us that it was put in book form. And if we made it available in audio, then, of course, with the technology today, you would have ran with it. But this forces you to read and gives us the incentive to put some additions to it when we discuss the beginning of time and the creation of God. Joining me in this segment is a brother that I call him Brother Believer, and he's none other than my dear friend, Brother Nazar. As-salamu alaykum.
Walaykum salam, sir.
How are you?
Fine, sir.
Now, you are very observant, and you certainly know how to listen if you don't know how to do anything else. You've always been able to do that, haven't you?
Yes, sir.
Well, I wanted you to come in because I want to play something from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad from what's called a labor's tape. And this labor's tape is so important because the messenger is giving out instructions and he does it so well and in that strong voice. And that was an important time in our history. Mm-hmm. And lots of people on the horizon who are beginning to pick up here and there of Elijah, they never go into depth about him. And he's so profound. Over the years, you've listened to it because we've had classroom settings. So you're familiar with the labor state.
Yes, sir.
So your thoughts about it before I play something you think is appropriate?
Well, as you explained, you know, the authority coming from his voice, and one of the believers said in class today, how the messenger, how these were grown men and how humbled they were to take the instructions from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and listen to him and to carry those out.
Okay, so you mimicking what that brother said. So anything else you'd like to add?
Well, no, not that much.
So you put it clear?
Yes, sir, okay. Clear.
So well, what we're going to do, brothers and sisters, let me say, I want you to call a friend. Then I want you to go to YouTube and subscribe to my channel. Now, it's almost embarrassing sometimes when I look at the YouTube and I see such few people are subscribed, but they tell me on Facebook that I'm on a couple of pages there. I forget how you put it on my regular page and another page. When they say it's over 5,000, I don't know. But I'd love that to be for my YouTube subscribers, because that means we'll notify you immediately when we're going live. And we've decided, we've been so excited about the live shows on Sundays and Wednesdays, and we love the interaction with you. We thought about another edition, you know, so we'll keep you posted, but if I don't see any evidence, it's really no use in me doing that. And but, you know, you have to help us out, because I love that interaction. Anyway, I'm going to take a break, and then I'm going to come back after you've heard a little something of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. But let me caution you on this. We take pride in when we have these discussions about him. After all, this is called Muhammad and Friends. And today marks 24 years and 3 months that we've been on the air. I didn't say 2 years and 4 months or 2 hours. 24 straight, uninterrupted years that we've been on television. And you might say, so what? Well, I'll go along with you. So what? Well, I think we've made a difference, brothers and sisters, because we've brought people on who have enlightened you all over the world. And it has not been a local show. And for someone who didn't set out to be involved in TV and to be international in scope, I think that speaks highly for the production operation, and especially when we go on the road and you see the editing crew jump to full speed. And that's why I want to commend these people. I think I have the best people in television, and but it always gets me when I'm out and about and people want to relegate our show to somewhere it's just on cable. Hell, I think I saw Anderson Cooper on cable, and I know his name, and the Reliable Sources is on cable. So what? So brothers and sisters, stop attempting to be demeaning, because you got to go to the mountaintop to catch up to make demeaning relevant to a person of my caliber. I'll just say that to you. Take it for what it's worth. So we're streaming live all over the entire world. If you don't believe me, call your friends in Spain. I know someone is watching in Afghanistan, and you know that's a long ways away. So we're going to take a break, and we're going to play something, and then we'll give you a little education briefing if you don't mind. We're streaming live all over the entire world. We'll be right back.
Circuit record myself all the time. I have to have help. Yes, to keep a record. I almost have to have help for myself. If my Lord didn't keep a record of me, I would be lost. So don't think anything strange of that. As you know, that we have been all but universally attacked. Here for the last 4 or 5 months, especially, universally attacked. And this attack was for the purpose of getting rid of me. And I don't know who all is behind the attack. I have been trying to keep quiet to try to learn just the strength of the attack. No general can put his army against another army until he knows the strength of that army. So I have not been, say, sleeping on the job. I have been trying to learn just the source and strength of my enemy. So I wish that you remember this, that this kind of attack that has been made on me personally and indirectly on you
because attack on me should be on you too. Should have hurt us gravely. But it didn't so far. It has not so far, because you're still here. And we still have our temples with the same followers. So the attack is not so powerful yet enough to destroy Muhammad. I would like that you get this in mind, ministers, as you are my helpers, that these kind of attacks, as you're not through with them, we have something else to face yet. May not be the same nature, but we have attacks yet to come on us. I don't want to excite you now in the very least. Don't get excited in the very least, because if I'm not excited and I am the hare in front of the hound, I don't think you should get excited. The hound wants me most of all. And you must arm yourself with truth from scripture, you know, standpoint, to prove my position.
Assalamu alaikum. We're back. And brothers and sisters, as always, I'm going to give my guest first, and then I'm going to explain to you some things from my version. But we always have students. And you may say, well, what do y'all do over the crow? What are you hanging around crow for? You just got some evidence. When you can get instructions from the Lord of the world, the messenger, you know, but you really getting from the Lord of the world, because it's coming through him. He's as close as his jugular vein, we believe. But it's so beautiful, and like he said, he's removing that fear from you. Just like that girl used to sing this song, remove this doubt from my heart, because we know doubt is the mother of hypocrisy. So the messenger was feeding us at an important time. What are your thoughts, brother, when you hear that?
Well, again, brother, thanks for having me on the show. And having the history, and that's the history that I wanted to get involved with, and knowing this history and having tapes like that, we can go back and learn from the messenger. Listen to this man talk. It's not like somebody, you know, he talks different. And if he met with God, that's who I want to listen to, somebody who has that confidence in those type of instructions. And I've never heard of somebody who can speak like that, and you know, it just captures me.
See, a lot of people, because the messenger was so un-American, they really don't get it. But brothers and sisters, for those of you who don't know, that was in August of 1965, 64. I don't want to get them confused. But that was when it was really a lot of turmoil in the Nation of Islam. And the Honorable Elijah, so it had to be 64, because Malcolm was still around. And the messenger called in his captains, his ministers, and his secretaries to give them the instructions that they needed, and those who may have been frightened to let them know they can catch up with their crowd.
Teach.
You understand? He'll take it from here. He said, but if you don't see him shaking, don't you start shaking. And so this is what we love about it, because it is so beautiful when you have a man like that, and it triggers so many other things when the messenger talks. But just think about this. He knew they were coming from our right, our left, in front and behind. This is why he taught us scripture, so we would be prepared to offset those naysayers, the propaganda machine, the tricknology. And that's why he was cool, calm and collected, never let it bother them. But periodically, we have to go back and show you what we know.
Right.
Because there are times you think we've gotten confused. But brother and sister, when we get confused, we just pull one another's coat and say, have you been in the library lately?
Right.
You know, have you been in the vault lately? Say, if you haven't been in the vault, I was in the vault the other day listening to something that brought me to reality. So that's why I wanted to bring my brother up. But I'm going to talk to you about a lot of things, and I'm going to bring different people up. And I love witness bearing, and I want you to interact. But before I do, I've been informed, as I say, we're streaming live all over the entire world. I told you we were international in scope. And one of my very good friends have let me know that he's watching from Zimbabwe. Yes, that's what I said. I said Zimbabwe. I didn't say Roosevelt City. I didn't say Bessemer, Alabama. I said Zimbabwe, where Mugabe ruled for so long, where we spent time at Heroes Acres, where we watched and dealt with the freedom fighters in Zimbabwe, showing you the revolutionary people there, and they still watch us today because we have an impact wherever we go, because we don't come begging, we come with civilization and talking about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad wherever we might go. So I send the greetings to my dear brother Robert, where my Mayor Reynolds tried to make soldiers out of them for himself, and he got caught. And so that's what I'm saying. You can't play with God's people wherever they are, because once we get them and deal with truth, they're going to be prepared for that. So I'm going to take a break, and I'm going to come back, brothers and sisters, with another interesting guest, and we're going to go down our memory lane in the interim. But remember what I told you. I always keep this in mind. This is the archive. What makes this the archive? Because you can't steal the material from us. We tried to explain that to you when you were doing your thievery with Muhammad Ali, your thievery with all the others that you stole from us and made them who you are, you know? And you do know that you've been a thief. Some people have stolen our history, but we keep the history out front, and you saw two comedians, Bill Clinton, the president on Saturday Night Live, and that other little boy who Muhammad Ali inadvertently made rich. But he made him rich. And see, this is what I'm saying. They crack a joke, emulate your voice, they get paid, and it took Muhammad Ali death in order for his son, with his namesake, to finally get some money. So I'm going to take a break. You go figure and see if this 24 years of Crow TV, whether it's been important or not. We're going to take a break, and we'll come right back and talk more on the other side. We'll be right back.
You mean the Malcolm X that followed Elijah Muhammad, the Malcolm X that Elijah Muhammad took out of prison and converted and cleaned and made wise, all the Malcolm X that diverted and totally went hypocritical against Elijah Muhammad? Which Malcolm was he talking about? Now, this is a good question. Everybody will know about Malcolm. Malcolm was just a student and a follower of Elijah Muhammad. That's all. The truth that I heard. I went to the Muslim mosque in 1960 when I first went to Miami training for professional fighting. I went to a Muslim meeting. And as soon as I heard it, I knew this is what I've been looking for all of my life. When the man proved to me that I was not a Negro, that Cassius Clay was not my name, and I didn't know my language or my culture, my religion. And when he showed me I didn't completely know myself, then I had to sit and listen. Well, Malcolm X didn't become disillusioned. He did a few unwise things. A plane crashed in Europe somewhere with 130 whites on it from Atlanta. And he praised the death of these people dying such a tragic death. And Elijah Muhammad had to dismiss him for 3 months because he spoke for himself, not for the movement. And when Kennedy died, he also jumped up and praised Kennedy's death. The first white man that I've seen who really wanted to do something, tried to do right, couldn't seem to be right with me. And many people were grieving at the time Kennedy died, mainly Negroes. They cried more than white people. And this was an unwise thing for a man representing some 700,000 followers to stand up and praise a man like Kennedy's death. So Elijah Muhammad, then the boss, he had to set him down for like 6 months, told him that Malcolm X didn't represent me. And he said, the country has lost a good president. It was on the next day of the Muhammad Sheikh newspaper. And Malcolm was brainwashed by all these cameras, white people telling him how good he spoke, telling him he should be the leader. And he one day believed it, that he was the leader. And if you knew nothing about Muslims, you would have thought that Malcolm X was the leader because he got all the press. Like me, I'm standing up here talking about the Muslims. But you don't call Elijah Muhammad here. You call all the students, but you won't call Elijah Muhammad. And he was destroyed by the cameras. And when he was put out, he came to my house in Florida. I paid his way and his family.
Assalamu alaikum. We're back. And brothers and sisters, I have another guest on the live line. We're going to talk to him momentarily. But I just want you to stop and walk with me for a moment. This is why I tell you to call someone. Tell them we're streaming live because the information that you miss may just save your life. And it's really exciting when I know you're walking with us and you're picking up information. Did you hear what Muhammad Ali said? He said that, of course, when Kennedy died, Negroes cried more than white people, because that's the kind of people we are. But he also told you that he was a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. When he went to a Muslim meeting in Miami, training for a fight, he was so overwhelmed because he didn't know his language. He didn't know his name. He was backwards. All the knowledge of self had been taken. And he had to sit up and listen when a man was telling him who he was. And this wasn't even the leader. This was one of the students of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Now, you have taken this over the years and ran with it because you're so filled with hatred for the messenger because the propaganda machine was so thorough in making you to hate someone that you didn't even know. Reverend Sister, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad loved you more than you loved yourself. And this is why he still reigns as king and he's been gone for over 40 years. And you wouldn't even know that he was gone because his message is so clear and it continues no matter what they try to do to usurp him, they can't stop him. And I even saw on reliable sources today where they interject Minister Farrakhan again, trying their best to dehumanize him. See, they do this to you. But Muhammad Ali, they decided we're going to buy his name, we're going to clean him up, and we're going to make them forget he was ever with the messenger of God. How did they do that? you went to sleep. It said, I travail a second time until Christ be formed in us. See, brothers and sisters, we have root knowledge. This is why they can't get us. So then every now and then they throw a curve at you and tell you how anti-white we are. We anti-this, we anti-that. We get along with people who get along with us. We're civilized people. But I'm telling you one thing that we're not thieves. And we don't steal other people's identity. We're overwhelmed by the identity that we have under the umbrella, the original man, the owner, the maker, the cream of the planet Earth, the God of the universe. You can joke about it if you want it, but it's true. If it hadn't been for us, you could have never been. And you got to take that to the bank, black brother, black sister. Be proud that you're who you are. And Muhammad Ali, like he said, as long as I'm with the messenger, you can't get me. But he made a mistake. He went to sleep. Ask that girl, the one who invited the minister to come down there to Muhammad Ali's funeral and then was so embarrassed that he couldn't even be on the stage. But he knew Muhammad Ali better than she did. She grew up as an admirer. But then afterwards, they all want to be apologetic. I said it. I can say it because it's true. They used her like they use most Negroes when it comes to the Muslim, make you think we the boogeyman, and if it wouldn't be for the Muslim, then you would have no thoughts at all. You think that you waking up on your own? You think you really know something about blackness? You got to be crazy. That's why you keep quoting Malcolm, Muhammad Ali, Minister Farrakhan. Why you quote them if you don't think we know anything? And you're really quoting the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and you don't know it. So, brother and sister, I want to be as cordial and as congenial as, as vivacious as possible. You got that? All right, look it up. Okay, joining me now is my friend all the way from Maryland. I love him dearly. He's a great brother, a family man, but most of all, he's a teacher, and he's not bashful. He teaches if he knows it. Our friend and brother, Dr. Tyrone Powell. As-salamu alaykum. Well, we got to turn you up, Doc. Turn Doc up so I can hear. Yeah, we're Skyping, brothers and sisters, with the wonderful Dr. Tyrone Powell. You got me, Doc? Now we got to turn that up now. We got to turn it down? Well, Doc, look like we got to come back and get your voice on track. But I'll editorialize until they get you straight, okay? Our brothers and sisters, we're about to stream live with Dr. Tyrone Powers. You know him. He's a brother. He shoots straight. He does shoot straight now because he's in target practice. You know, he was a former FBI agent, and they tell me they can hit you at 1,000 feet. And so he was a marksman. He certainly knew something about counterintelligence, and that's why we certainly have him with us as a brother. And remember I told you all when we started Crow, we wanted to have a nurse, a doctor, a lawyer, everything except a liar. But we wanted professional people, and you made that happen. And we have friendship all in all walks of life. John Carlo is listening to us via Facebook. John, when you were in Chicago the other week, you come to Chicago, you don't even call me. You got to do better. Maybe we'll Skype with you next time, but we love you. You know, John Carlos, who revolutionized the Black Power side and in the Olympics, right?
Yes, sir.
So we thank him for tuning in to us. And most of you around the world, brothers and sisters, pick up the phone. Call us, 773-434-6625 or 773-434-6631. Wherever you're listening to us from, we want you to call us and engage in conversation. But I heard a teaching today by one of our sisters. She is so gifted, and I'm so proud of her because she's rooted in the protectionism of God and His messenger. And you can see it, you feel it, from her, but when she opens her mouth, she just, you can see the divinity that flows. And I'm thankful to God that we've raised people like that by having the forum to investigate for themselves. And that's all you're doing, brothers and sisters, is investigate. We don't have nothing of our own, but we got it from the man who got it from God, and he gave it to us. Now, I tell you what I'm going to do while I'm waiting for Dr. Powers. I'm going to take another break, and I'm going to play something else that I think that you might like and you may not like, but I don't know, depending on what day it is. Oh, well, what is today? The 28th, isn't it? Okay, I'm going to take another break, brothers and sisters, and I want you to go down memory lane. Don't be bashful with us, but call us down and let us know you're watching. And then I want you to subscribe to the YouTube channel, those of you that are watching on YouTube. In fact, how many of you are watching on YouTube? Let me have two people to call me and tell me who's watching on YouTube, and I want two people from Facebook to call me and let me know that you're watching. Okay? We're going to take a break, and we'll come back and talk more on the other side. We'll be right back.
Scribe us to what now? What
to his religion, or to his movement? Not even James Baldwin.
I would say this to you. Everything that black people are doing today come from Nabi Elijah Muhammad. They're having school problems. We want black schools. We want black teachers. This is his program. Being natural. They are black now. They don't want to be called Negroes. This comes from Nabi Elijah Muhammad.
Does that really make any difference?
Hold it. At the latest Black Power Conference, all the black leaders got together and said, we want separate states from whites. This is stolen from Nabi Elijah Muhammad. They want their own schools. They want their own businesses, supermarkets. They're now talking about...
If you say they stole it from him, suppose I say he stole it from the communists.
Hold it.
What I'm trying to say
is that everything that our people are doing today, every leader that you can bring up from Ron Karinga, the Black Panthers, Elgish Cleaver, Malcolm X, Stokely Carmichael, Rap Brown, people such as myself in the struggle. Everybody you can name talking black or preaching anything black, they are ex-Muslims. They heard it from the, when you say why they don't follow it, they're following and don't know it, but they haven't yet accepted him religiously.
Now, if you say that there is a correspondence between what he preaches and what other black leaders preach, the answer is yes, that's true. The question is, what is the significance of that correspondence? Is the correspondence between what the Democratic Party wants and the Communist Party wants? It doesn't mean that one dominates the other.
I understand. Major question was, how come 97% rejects him?
Yeah.
Then 97% of the people really don't know enough about him to really reject him or hate him. But they are so enticed by the wealth of America. For an example, I have a black friend. I could be a Muslim. I go for what you go for. I believe the white man's the devil, but not the woman. I got a pretty white girl. So he can't join because he's got a white girlfriend.
Yeah, he's not sincere.
You understand? So this is why he haven't joined. Mm-hmm. Another fella. I go for the Muslims. I go for everything you preach, but I got to have my pork chops and ham hocks. I can't quit eating my pork.
Yeah.
Another fellow, what's wrong with a little reefer? You understand? To be a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, you have to completely abstain from alcohol, fornication, adultery, killing, stealing, lying.
Gets tougher and tougher.
Well, yes, you can. Same with, yeah. Even in the days of Jesus, in the days of Moses, and everything that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad...
Assalamu alaikum. We are back. And brothers and sisters, can't you see? See, that's the Muhammad Ali. Does it seem like we rehearsed it? Muhammad Ali dead. But you still heard him, right? So I'm just telling you, stop and listen. Now, do we have our brother, Dr. Powers, are you there? I still don't hear him, brother. Did we turn it up? Hello, Doc? Now, you know, we should have this thing together. We don't, okay. It must be you, Doc. Okay, Carla, you on the air. Hello, Carla, where you calling from?
This is Carlos calling from Carlos, Georgia, Cartersville, Georgia.
Carlos, okay, this is my son, Carlos, but they think you want Carlos from Puerto Rico. I mean, my brother, the Juan Carlos. But anyway, I'm glad you called, sir. How can I help you?
I just want to congratulate you on 24 uninterrupted years on television.
That's
a great accomplishment.
That's good. Your daughter was in the studio. I don't know if she left me or not, brother, because she said she was going to stay to the show. But I'm sure she'd be excited her daddy was calling in. Thank you so much, son. Have a good day.
You too, sir.
Hey, what's the weather like in Georgia?
It's pretty nice. Sun is shining.
You know, I had to tell them to make sure they know you weren't in the next room. You know, you'd be surprised the kind of operation our people believe in. Thank you, son.
Yes, sir.
Something like. Carla, you on the air?
Hey, I'm Salam Salaikum, Brother Maria. This is your brother Sydney calling from the Bronx, New York.
Hey, Sydney, yes. I'll be in New York tomorrow, and you know what? I'm gonna come to Bronx, and damn, I ain't gonna take you out on the golf course. You can't say Assalamu alaikum yet.
Yes, I did. I said Assalamu alaikum.
No. Take your time. I'm not gonna let you butcher that because it means so much. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
There you go. How are you, my dear brother Sydney?
I'm doing fine. I'm doing fine. And yourself?
Thank you for calling.
And congratulations on your 24 years.
Thank you so much, my dear brother. And remember, we stream live all the time, and what you can do is subscribe to the channel, brothers and sisters. Now, joining me in the studio is one of our more humble brothers. We love him a lot. He's a great brother. He's none other than Brother Sharif Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, sir.
So, Sharif, you're one of the brothers with logic, and you show your humility all the time. And we're certainly not trying to make mockery of our people. But how do you see them being able to condemn the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and when Muhammad Ali constantly have told you, everything I got from the man. And they don't believe it because they say, well, he didn't get in the ring and box for you. But Muhammad Ali had wit. He was smart.
Yes, sir.
And he didn't always appear that way.
Well, unfortunately, brother, that's not the Muhammad Ali that's presented. If they don't watch this show, they wouldn't see that Muhammad Ali. You know, I had never seen that Muhammad Ali until I came to Crow.
Even though when you thought back, you saw him, but you saw him as a big mouth.
I never saw that Muhammad Ali.
You
didn't. I never saw the Muhammad Ali that was a minister of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Saw the Muhammad Ali that was the Louisville Lip, the fighter, I'm pretty. Can't nobody beat me. I'm the baddest. I'm the greatest.
What I mean.
But I never saw the Muhammad Ali that was just interviewed by William Buckley. I never saw that Muhammad Ali.
Did you see the Muhammad Ali who said, this is the greatest time of my life?
I never saw that Muhammad Ali.
Well, maybe we should take a break.
I mean, I saw it. I've seen it, of course, since I've been here.
If you haven't seen it that much, I think we're entitled to take a break.
I was 2 years old when that occurred.
Well, okay. So. That's somebody else that may not have been born.
Sure.
In 1974, Muhammad Ali had won the champ. Do we have Dr. Powers back? Let me see. Are you there, Doc? Doc, are you there? I don't know this volume, but something is wrong, Doc. Maybe the government is, you sure they don't have a plan? You were on Fox News yesterday. Well, look, brothers and sisters, Dr. Powers was going to give us some expert knowledge on the bombing that took place, how they were able to track them down so quickly. And he was going to touch on a little of what Trump said relative to what happened at the Jewish synagogue. You know, because Trump thinks the answer is is to have a gun everywhere. Even though in Chicago synagogue, they did hire one person who has a gun and someone to monitor. And I think you have a doorbell. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I don't think arming people is necessarily the answer, but it certainly, I guess, would have deterred the guy from shooting.
But I don't,
with all the people that in our neighborhood, that in our communities, that get killed on a daily basis, that go uncelebrated, if you will, undiscussed, then I don't really give too much thought to
that. Well, I think what happens, brother, but when you're dealing with civilized people, they force people to come and acknowledge what's going on. In our community, you know, they even put it in the movie. They say, well, they're just animals
anyway,
and they get away with that.
Right.
If something like that happens. So that's why people don't take it serious with us. But other people, they do take it serious because they force them to respect them, as we should force people to respect us. Doctor, I'm so sorry I can't get you. You're still not there with me, huh?
He's calling.
Okay, well, we're going to get him on the phone or something. Brothers and sisters, when we're streaming live, Doc, we can't do you that much good. Are you there, Doc? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Doc, I don't know what is going on with this audio. It makes the people think that they're working on us now. You know about counterintelligence. Was it for you not to talk to us today or what?
I don't know, Brother Manea, but I'm glad to be with you.
Yeah, I'm glad. Now, look, I was just trying to speak for you. What can you tell me about this bombing? Because I was impressed, because all they needed was one little fingerprint. But it's hard for them to find anything about domestic terrorism when it comes to you and I. If you recall, 20 years ago, you and I did a show about domestic terrorism. They refused to call it that when they were bombing the churches. Do you recall that?
Yes, sir. And that was definitely domestic terrorism, and obviously, clearly, is this, because domestic terrorism, by definition, from the Department of Justice and the FBI, is violence or the threat of violence with political or social objectives designed to coerce or influence the government. And clearly, in the case of the black churches, that was for political or social objectives. But we didn't push the envelope, Brother Manea. Me and you talked about it, but some of the other organizations, I remember President Clinton being invited to places and discussing the fact that these were retired Klansmen, and the question never being asked, how do you retire from the Klan if you're going to burn churches? So they can pretty much say anything to us if we lack the knowledge to ask questions back, to go into it deeper. And when we don't do that, these things continue to happen in black America because no one pushed the envelope. On the contrary, when it happens like it did with the bombings, clearly everyone can take the definition of domestic terrorism and apply it and then put all the mechanisms in place to identify those who are doing it and those who may be associated with them and continue investigation to see if anyone knew about it, because they want to go after those too.
You know, Doc, let me say this. And maybe sometime I show too much humor, but I'm so serious that it hurts me that people don't pay us more attention. As you said, you remember when you and I talked about it, but quite frankly, it was not picked up. I was telling someone who pretends they work for a paper called The Defender here, but I say what The Defender has in Chicago, they might as well take pictures. That's what I call them, because there's no news. And they don't try to find news, even when you're presenting it to them. Just as we were talking before, I'm on television. If just the idea of me bringing a person on like you, who's so professional, who's been in the counterintelligence business for a long time, you retired from the FBI, this is a scholarly look at things that you do. The white people call you every day, and they want to talk to you. I've been in Baltimore when you were in demand. Now, I'm saying that to say, how can we make our people to understand that this is TV? This is a source of information that we're giving. When are we going to support our own so we can start to know what to ask for and not what to just to accept anything?
Yeah, it's kind of a remarkable thing, Brother Manier, because even as we have this particular conversation, there are black congresspeople, black political leaders across the nation that can't even delve into this in the right way. I went to a hearing and they were having with some legislators, and they weren't even asking the right questions about the domestic terrorism that we're experiencing in our community, the organizations, because these organizations not just what we saw at the Pentagon or yesterday and not just what we saw with the bombing, have increased their membership, have increased their weaponry, and have targeted and intend to target organizations in the black community, throughout the black community, and we need to know that. Our political leaders need to know that. Our schools need to put security in place to know that, because that's their plan, and we know that's their plan. And so it's incumbent upon the political leaders to not just talk about and give rhetoric to the events that have already occurred, or like the Pentagon bombing or the bombs that are being sent out, but to immediately bring this back so it has meaning in our community and make sure that our community is prepared for the eventuality of one of these attacks, since we know there's been a massive increase in these organizations, since we know they are arming themselves, since we know that they feel freer to carry out this particular violence, almost supported by the government at this day and time. So there's a rising storm, and we probably won't deal with it because even our politicians are focused on something else until something happens. To a group of our children die, or one of our organizations are attacked and some of our people are hurt, then we'll come back to it. But the lesson to learn is right now. The preparation is right now, and the conversation is right now. But again, many of our politicians can't even define domestic terrorism, much less prepare for it.
Now, I'm glad you took that. I'm going to take a caller, and then I'm going to take a break, Doc. I don't want you to leave. And Sharif may have a question when we come back. Caller, you're on the air. Hello, caller?
Yeah, this is Brother David down in Norfolk, Virginia.
How you
calling from the House of Consciousness.
How are you, brother?
I'm fine, brother. After hearing Muhammad Ali speaking today, you know, I just wanted to call in and just thank Allah, Almighty God, for the restricted law of Islam that give us guidance on how to live our life. And I just want to thank you, brother, for everything you do. And I just want to put that out there. If a man don't have any guidance, given the restricted law.
Well, let me say, I want to thank you, Brother David, for calling in and the people in the House of Consciousness. And that's what happens when so many of you are conscious. I wish it was some more houses of consciousness around the country, and we're going to work on that. Doc, that's our friends calling from Norfolk, Virginia, David Muhammad in the House of Consciousness, and those are the kind of people who, when you're in D.C., I'll be happy to entertain you. Now, look,
yes,
I'm going to take a quick break. I want to bring up another guy with me to close us out. We're streaming live all over the entire world. So sorry we had the difficulty with Dr. Powers, but you can hear him on the radio. I'll be on the radio WTMR 10 radio. Where will I be? Camden, New Jersey. Dr. Powers going to make up for this. Are you not, Doc?
Yes, sir.
All right. So we're going to take a break, and we'll come back and entertain another guest. We'll be right back.
Yet. You can't say my legs are gone. You can't say I was tired, because what happened? I didn't dance from the second round on. I stayed on the ropes. When I stay on the ropes, you think I'm doing bad. But I want all boxers to put this in the page of boxers. Staying on the ropes is a beautiful thing with a heavyweight when you make him shoot his best shots and you know he's not hitting you. I would have gave George Foreman two rounds of steady punching, because after that he was mine. But he was falling. He was missing. I don't know if I'm going to fight again or not. I'm going to retire as of now. I have to talk to my leader, the most honorable.
Are you still planning to retire?
Almighty God Allah, I want all of you fans out there who believe in me, read the Muhammad Speaks newspapers, go to your local Muslim temple, and learn more about the life-giving power from Allah through Elijah Muhammad that I've got. You saw all the white people, the critics, the world had me ranked to go down. This was that man, and Allah, God was with me, and this man looked like nothing.
Right.
I want you to remember that. Want to know where I get the power? Visit your local Muslim mosque. Read that Muhammad Speaks newspaper. Right. Take it from me.
That just proves you can have commercials on closed circuit television just as you can have it on real television. Muhammad, what did you say to George Foreman?
No, it's not a commercial. No, telling people to believe in God.
Tell me, what did you say to George Foreman before the fight? What did you say?
I told him he has no power. In the corners and in the clinches, I said, shoot your best shot. I'm going back to the ropes. They told me he was strong. Didn't I look stronger than him?
Why didn't tell me, Muhammad, this is the thing that puzzled people. Why was it when you were on the ropes that he could not hurt you, even when you were right there on the ropes?
Blocking, and I was pulling back, and I have a radar built inside me. I know how to judge punches. Didn't I tell all of you out there on your local radio shows, mostly black stations, I told you, I'm going to float like a butterfly and sting like a bee. His hands can't hit what his eyes can't see. So that's what happened.
That's what you said to me. But tell me now, are you really going to retire, Muhammad?
I'm seriously thinking about retiring. There's nothing else for me to fight. I told him, well, I'm going to retire. I'm going to hold the title for a few months. They took my title unjustly. I told you, I'm the real champion. I told you, I'm the champion of the world. All of you bow. All of my critics crawl. All of you suckers who write the Ring magazine. Boxing those there. All of you suckers bow because the stage was set. You made him great. You made him a bad Joe Louis. You made him a hard puncher. But I want everybody from this moment on to recognize me as the scholar of boxing. If you want to know any damn thing about boxing, don't go to no boxing experts in Las Vegas. Don't go to no Jimmy DeGree. Come to Muhammad Ali. I am the man.
One last question, Muhammad.
Hello, my man, Hugh Hefner. Hugh Hefner out there.
Muhammad, one last question. Tell me, would you say that this at this moment, is this the happiest moment of your life?
No. Happiest moment of my life when I met Elijah Muhammad, the freedom speaker of black people. But I want to say this.
As-salamu alaykum, we are back. Now, brothers and sisters, I told you, we normally don't accept liars. But he asked Muhammad Ali, is this the greatest moment of your life? Can you imagine the euphoric feeling? $5 million. You just did the unthinkable. And they ask you, is this the greatest moment of your life? And he purposely stopped and looked into the camera and told you the greatest moment is when he met Elijah Muhammad. Now, do you need more? Yosef, what would that have done for you?
That is an amazing and remarkable statement that brother made. And it shows the greatness of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad because, like you said, to be in that euphoric moment, to be rattled with emotion, but to have the presence of mind to understand what was being asked and to answer it so articulate with, no, my greatest moment is when I met the messenger of God. And I think that can be an example, especially for our people, to have that same presence of mind. And as you, brothers, so eloquently spoke of the situations that were happening in America, and I want our people to realize that we have to be on guard and we have to have that presence of mind when we see these threats. A lot of times we look at these situations and we dismiss people because they don't fit the mold that America has presented as terrorists or as intelligence as far as having the ability to carry out such atrocious acts. And because we've been failed victim of this idea of somebody having a turban or being from what they call the present day Middle East as terrorists, when we see real terrorists who cause terror throughout this planet come into our environment and then wreak havoc, we dismiss them because we use them or they have a suit on or they have a punk rock hat on. So no, they're not harmless. They may be just a little mentally disturbed. Yeah. No, we have to have the presence of mind to know that they come in all forms and fashion and we have to always be well equipped in how to handle those situations. Because, you know, those are ultimately the people that's going to bring the most detriment to us.
Very good. Sheree, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, I would have to agree with Brother Yosef. You know, I always, when I teach a self-defense seminar or something like that, one of the things I always say is self-defense is a mindset. It's a mentality. You know, it's not necessarily all about knowing how to defend yourself physically. It's about getting in the mental state to look for things that could potentially be a threat. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you may not be able to identify physically a threat, mm-hmm. you know, but if you're aware that a threat could possibly come, then you'll be prepared for it when it does come. And as Brother Yosef said, you know, as I was saying earlier, the messenger talked about being the skunk of the planet Earth. Mm-hmm. He's stinking up everything. Mm-hmm. We got to make sure we pay attention mm-hmm. that these people are still who the messenger said they are. They are the devil in person. And we have to be aware of that and make that regardless of what their outward appearance.
Well, just because you are paranoid don't mean they're not out to get you. Okay, well, brothers and sisters, Dr. Powers is true to his word. He's going to be with me on Camden, New Jersey on Tuesday night. And we're going to be streaming live WTMR radio, 9:30 Eastern time. So you'll be looking for me. And we're going to do a town hall meeting in Camden, New Jersey, New York, one of them, tomorrow night. Yeah, I can't do one here in Chicago, so at least I can do one in Camden. They gave me the key to Camden. I'm going to see if I can go and unlock some. Mm-hmm. Okay? So, my dear brothers and sisters, I want to thank each and every one of you for watching. And remember, Muhammad Ali told you the greatest moment of his life. It's too bad that little girl helped him to go out the wrong way. And I know they don't. They don't blame her. She was just a little girl. I blame her. Because when she found it, mm-hmm. he told her what he believed. And we work night and day to usurp what a brother believes. And that's what I'm saying. Jacob the Supplanter, he comes in many different colors. Thank you for watching. May Allah bless you with the light of understanding as I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum.